Typically, one of the first things you'll do when you start an algebra class is you'll take some time and review the different types of numbers you'll be using in your algebra class. So let's take just a few minutes and go over some of the different types of numbers that you can expect to see in your algebra class. The first set is the set of natural numbers. The natural numbers you can think of as like the counting numbers that you learn as a child that start at 1 and then go 2, 3, 4, 5, etc., and they never stop. So using set notation, we can write curly brace, the starts our set, with a 1 and a 2 and a 3 and a 4. And once the pattern's clear, we can just say dot, 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 and then close it with a curly brace. And that indicates that the set will continue on for forever. And usually we'll do three dots to indicate that we're continuing on for forever. Now there's another set that includes the natural numbers that's a little larger. It includes all the natural numbers and the number zero. Most people do not include zero in what we call the natural numbers. Some actually do. It's actually not everybody is on the same page in this regard, but most people consider the natural numbers going from 1 to infinity, where the whole numbers would include 1 through infinity but would also include 0. So this is the normal convention of most people. Okay, so we have 0 through infinity would be called the whole numbers. Now the integers, you've probably heard of the integers before. The integers are whole numbers, but they're the positive whole numbers and the negative whole numbers, and they include zero as well. So the way to write this as being extended out in both directions, we will put zero in the middle and put like 1, 2, 3 on one side with a dot, dot, dot. And then to the left of zero, we'd have -1, -2, oh, kind of running out of space here, -3, dot, 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 going out to the left as well. Probably should have left myself a little bit more space, but you get the idea. We're going to the left with the negative numbers and to the right with the positive whole numbers, and together the positives and the negatives and zero make up what we call the integers. All right, now the rational numbers are a little bit different. To write a rational number, basically what you have is a fraction where you have one integer divided by another integer. Now it's a little bit more complicated to write that or just kind of whip out a definition where you separate them by commas. So instead I'm going to use something called a set builder notation, where I'm going to write it this way. I'm going to write the set of all elements that look like P over Q such that P and Q are elements of the integers. Now, just to keep me from writing a bunch of words, let me stop for a minute. I'm going to show you something else as well. Mathematicians are always looking for shortcuts. If they can find a shortcut, they'll take it. Natural numbers and whole numbers and integers can be expressed with one letter. For example, the natural numbers, you often see this in textbooks, where they'll write a capital N that kind of looks like a bold capital N. This font is actually called Blackboard Bold because this is how most instructors write bold letters on a blackboard. So it's pretty intuitive. So this is the natural numbers. The integers are also written with a capital letter, but weirdly enough, it's actually written with a capital Z. A capital Z. Capital Z stands for the integers. You can use a capital W for the whole numbers, but most people focus on writing a capital N for natural and capital Z for the integers. So anyway, back to what I was saying about the rational numbers, we can say that this is the set of all elements that look like P over Q such that P and Q are elements of the integers. Okay. Now, if you're not familiar with set builder notation, you might want to refer back to my previous video where we talked about set builder notation. But this basically says in fancy terms, you basically have one integer divided by another integer. And actually, I need to add in one other thing as well, one other stipulation. You cannot have Q being zero. So I'll also say that Q is not allowed to be zero, because then you'd have division by zero, which creates its own problems. So this is a nice clean way of saying every fraction number, 2/3, -5/8, etc., etc. All right, now the rational numbers can be designated by a letter as well. They're designated by a capital Q. Q stands for quotient. Quotient's like a fraction. And so we have these three letters that represent these three major sets of numbers. All right, let me say one other word about rational numbers before we go on. Usually when we think about rational number, what comes into our mind is the word fraction. And that's okay. That's not a bad thing, because that's true. 2/3 is a rational number, 5/8, etc., etc. But another way you should think of rational numbers is also as being finite decimals. Think about this for a minute. If you had like 0.21, that's a decimal that ends. It ends at the one. You can always write this as something over 10 or something over 100 or something over 1,000, depending on how many digits your decimal has. So we could say, for example, this one would be 21 over 100, right? 21 out of 100. Well, bam, instantly we've written this as a fraction. So really any finite decimal is actually a rational number as well, or can be expressed as a fraction. Now, of course, you have your traditional fractions. You have like -2/3 or 7/8. Those would all be rational numbers as well. And there's actually one other way to be a rational number. You can actually have an infinitely long decimal be a rational number as long as it repeats itself. For example, a very common rational number that a lot of people know is 1/3 is equal to 0.333333 repeating. And so this is a decimal that repeats and repeats and repeats and repeats. You can write this as 0.3 with a bar over it, and that indicates that that digit repeats and repeats and repeats forever. So if you have a repeating decimal, you can actually write that as a fraction as well, which makes it be considered a rational number as well. So then that leaves one other type of number that's not rational. So if it's a finite decimal, automatically it's rational. So the only type of number that would not be rational is an infinitely long decimal, but that doesn't repeat, because even if it was a repeating infinitely long decimal, it would be rational. So if you had a decimal like 3.14159, and some of you would recognize this number. This is actually the number for pi, 3.14159. See no patterns here. 3.14159265358979, and it just goes on and on and on and on, and it never repeats and never repeats. This would be a number that is not rational, because it's an infinitely long decimal that doesn't repeat. So we actually have one higher set of numbers that we need to discuss. And to explain this better, I think it's actually best done in pictures. So let's think of it this way. We have our natural numbers. That's like your 1, 2, 3, etc. Then you have the whole numbers, which include 0 and 1 and 2 and 3, etc. Then outside of that, including the whole numbers and including the natural numbers, you have all your rational numbers. And even a natural number like 5. 5 is a natural number, but it's also a rational number, because you could express it as like 5 over 1, for example, or 2/3, or -7/8, etc. And so our largest set that we'll see in our class is called the real numbers. Now, what are real numbers exactly? Well, they would be considered all the rational numbers that we had before, as well as any numbers that are not rational. In other words, they're called irrational. So you would have numbers like 2/3, right? That would be a rational number. But you would also have numbers like pi, or the square root of 2, or -7, or 0. All of these numbers together, rational and irrational, thrown in a big basket, creates the set of real numbers. So anyways, that's the different types of sets that you can expect to see in your algebra class. There actually is one larger set of numbers that we're not going to talk about right now. If you want to study it on your own, it's called the complex numbers, but we'll study that one another day.